Welcome everybody to this lecture. My name is Jens Dittrich. I run the Big Data Analytics Group at Saarland University. And this is the Database Systems Core Lecture. So today I will tell you a little bit about what this topic is about, what the lecture is about. Then I will dive into administrative remarks. And afterwards we do a little recap session. So I will go through a couple of slides that I assume you know by now. So I assume that each of you attended some undergrad lecture in database systems here at Saarland University. The lecture is called Big Data Engineering. Previously it was called Informationssysteme. So you should have a basic knowledge about SQL, relational algebra, entity relationship modeling, stuff like that, transactions. I will go through that, and if you feel really uncomfortable with the material, I'll recap later on. Maybe this is not the right lecture, but if you feel like, hey, that material, I already know this stuff, and maybe with a little reading, I catch up, then that's the right lecture for you. So with that, let's start directly. I'll tell you a little bit about the concept, learning objectives, how the administrative things work, the tools we will use in this lecture, and so forth. So basically, when you look in the world of database systems, you will quickly run into many, many buzzwords, and I just listed some of them. So very old buzzwords or terms that were used like 20 years ago was information systems. So no one uses that anymore. A more fancy term is big data, you will find in that space, but also terms like data science, data lake, data engineering, and all kinds of stuff. Yeah? People use all kinds of these terms, and often the problem is that people don't really understand what they're talking about, in the sense that for many of these terms, there are multiple meanings associated with that. So it's often a bit risky to use these terms. But bottom line is, when you hear people talking about data, you will often hear some of those words. And there's, from the point of view of an academic, so I'm a professor, there's also quite a divide and quite a split when you look at industry. So if people in industry use terms like data lake, whatever that means, you don't have to understand that at this point in time. So those terms are often very vaguely defined, and from the point of view of an academic, it's hard to take sometimes, yeah, if people use these terms. So I will try in this lecture to use to avoid those buzzwords, because they don't really help on the discussion. Yeah, maybe a very common term these days that you hear people talking about is data science. It's also very hard to define. We have a new program here at Saarland University, started last year, data science and artificial intelligence. We have a bachelor and a master program. I coordinate those programs. If you're interested, you can also approach me. I can tell you more about that, but not now in this stream. But data science as a term has a similar problem, that it's a bit unclear what is meant by data science. And here's just one attempt of trying to approach that term a little bit. I'm not saying that this is a definition, no way, but this is a little bit giving you an idea what data science is about and why databases, what this lecture is about, is so highly related to that. So in data science, people somehow try to analyze data with various means, with very different methods. And basically, when you hear people talking about data science, they sometimes mean something like artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning stuff. Some people actually use data mining methods. Other use data management methods. And then there's another thing that is the application domain. So typically data science is about analyzing real data sets, solving real problems. That's what data science is about. And so basically you could say data science is a cake with very different pieces in that cake. So it's not just one strawberry cake or one apple cake. It's a cake that consists of very different types of methods and approaches to solving problems. But what's common to all of those approaches is definitely you need statistics, you need to understand statistics to make things happen, to don't do wrong things in that domain. You have to understand a little bit of linear algebra. Yes, you have to understand programming. There's tons of visualizations going on in that domain, and there's a lot of software engineering that's also required to make things happen. Yeah? So software engineering that goes beyond, I write it down in some Jupyter notebook and then everyone is happy. Yeah? That's not how you develop a product. In addition to that, in that domain, you need a lot of creativity to really solve problems. You need a lot of out-of-the-box thinking. You need that in general computer science as well, but in particular when it comes to analyzing data. Sometimes you just have to have the right idea and everything changes a lot. And if you don't have that idea, if you don't have the creativity, you can be stuck forever. Yeah, a third thing you need is grit. Grit means you don't stop if you can't solve the problem. You keep on trying until eventually you solve the problem. Sometimes you can't solve, there are problems that can't be solved, that happens. But you shouldn't give up too early, that's very important. And the other is team spirit in data science, also a property that's, of course, super important in general computer science as well, but in general data science, you will need that as well. So what I'm trying to tell you here is when people talk about data science, they often talk about machine learning only. Yes, sometimes when people say data science, they mean deep learning or whatever machine learning method is currently hyped, reinforcement learning, you name it, generative adversarial networks, whatever is going, whatever mentioned in the press currently. But a huge portion of that cake, of this data science cake, has to do with data management, actually. Yeah, how to get in the data, how to get your data into your models into the first place, yeah? How to extract certain features from the data, how to query the data meaningfully, and how to query the data in a way that these queries scale. Yeah? So often people play with little notebooks, with toy data sets, and then they try to scale it out to larger problems, and then all of a sudden they understand, oh, well, this doesn't scale, right? It's slow, yeah. And then it's sometimes not the problem of the model of the machine learning stuff, but it's the problem of the data management technology being used. So in this lecture, we will focus on these pieces of the cake, how to do the data management right, how to scale it, how to make it efficient, what are the algorithms behind efficient database systems. Yeah, and I'd like to say a few things about that, again, from the point of view of a professor, from because I watch both academia and industry, and there's a fun term that's called data baseologist. A colleague from Carnegie Mellon University, Andy Pavlo, coined that phrase, and I love that phrase. it doesn't really exist, it's more like a fun term, but it kind of is a good description for the research area I'm doing. And what I'd like to say here is basically the top conference where I'm publishing in, or where people in my research area have been publishing, is already called Very Large Databases. Yeah? So kind of a synonym for big data in a way. And in fact, as of today, 2020, it's fair to say that technically the management of and querying large amounts of data has long been solved. So there is no scalability problem. If people claim, oh, I can't get my data quickly enough from my database system, then that's not the fault of the system. It's rarely the fault of the system. It's in 99.99% of the cases a problem with the user, whoever configured the database system, the developer is retrieving that data, or whatever data scientist is retrieving the data. There's typically some misunderstanding on how databases work and how data can be retrieved efficiently. It's really, really a rare case that it's a fault of the system or an algorithm. Yeah? And that's important to keep in mind, because in industry and in the press, you often hear, oh, the database system is too slow. That doesn't work yet. That's not true. For the majority of the cases, it's just a wrong usage of those systems. And that's also a little bit what you will learn in this lecture. What are the major design patterns? What are the major techniques that, once you understand those major techniques, help you to scale any system and any problem in the world, no matter how big it is. So, yeah, what's also interesting currently is this combination of database technology with other areas in data science. As I showed to you in that cake above, so there's these other areas, data mining, machine learning. In particular, putting these pieces of the cake together, like saying, okay, oops, I have to, here's a little. So what is a combination of data management and machine learning, for instance? There's a lot of interesting work going on in my group. There are various projects trying to apply machine learning to database algorithms and stuff like that, but that's a longer story. Yeah, I think we can skip this one. That's not that important. Yeah, and the second thought about that, so what you often learn in your studies and in different lectures is you focus on the runtime complexity or the runtime efficiency, in the general case, of an algorithm. And yes, that's a concern, of course, that's super important, but that's not really what this lecture is about. We will run into this here and there and talk about that, of course, but the problem with big data sets is typically not the algorithm, but retrieving the data, getting the data fast enough to the CPU. Yeah, so what you hear, sometimes from developers is something like the data is somehow retrieved from some device, a file system that's relying on some device or some database system. Important is only the complexity of the algorithms. And this is completely wrong for many systems. On modern hardware, the CPU is no longer the bottleneck, but the slow delivery of data. So we will see several situations in this lecture where the CPU is simply idling. It could do more. It could do so much more computation. However, the data doesn't get into the CPU. And that may even happen if the data sits in main memory. Even then, you can construct and find situations where the data cannot be sent to the CPU quickly enough. That's typically the bottleneck in a data management system, database system, or big data system, however you name it, getting the data quickly enough in order to be processed by the CPU. And there are really wild examples you find out there in industry. So this is one example we ran into with my first startup where we do data science consulting, Daemon AI. And that's what we found with one of the customers. So you had a big Hadoop cluster that's basically a cluster allowing you to manage large data sets. And so he did some stuff with that, implemented stuff with Spark and Scala. Spark is a framework for handling big data sets. But basically, he just did it without conceptually designing how to do it the right way, how a databaseologist would do it in that case. And so we analyzed the situation. We found out, well, if you do a specific change in that setup that had to do with the data layout, how data is represented, is serialized to the devices he was using, then he could have speed up the queries by a factor 10,000. 10,000 times faster. So the dot is actually here. I should change that to the comma. So 10,000 times faster. And that would have implied in that scenario, actually, that he could throw away the Hadoop cluster. So here the reflex, and that's also something that can be observed in industry frequently, is that people buy big servers for the big data stuff, clusters, it's big data, it must be a big server. But the right thing to approach those problems is typically you take a piece of paper, think about a few things, and then often you can scale down those problems dramatically. In this case, this meant, you can run that on a laptop or a smartphone, and everyone is happy, and queries go like this, whatever query you run. So, And that's kind of the contrast we're seeing here. And what's very popular is in industry is a Kiwi pattern, which makes sense in many situations. So the idea behind the Kiwi pattern is to say, rather than developing a new software, rather than touching my existing software product, I buy a lot of hardware. Iron, kill it with iron. Yeah? You don't buy new software, you just add more SSDs, more CPUs, more servers in order to make things faster, in order to scale. And that may be a fair approach in certain situations, but sometimes it's better to use the other interpretation of Kiwi is to kill it with intelligence, to say, hey, what if I redid it and did something very different from what I have been doing so far? Yeah. And another important thing I need to mention here is There are basically two kinds of situations you encounter when you develop systems and handle data sets that analyze data or have to move data back and forth in a system. And there are situations where the database technology basically doesn't play a role. It doesn't matter. Huh? And that is the case when the data is small and the hardware is so fast that it makes no difference. You see that nowadays when people analyze data using Python. Huh? Python is a scripting language. And you would imagine, why would I use a scripting language for Python? But it doesn't really matter. It's fast enough for many purposes because, a couple of million rows in a data set, doesn't matter, you can do that in Python. However, if you try to scale it and eventually you add more data, you run into the tens and hundreds of millions, you will see the effects. Or for more complex queries, you will see the effects. And then database technology may play a role, it may play a big role, it may dominate all of what you're doing. You believe it's a fault of the algorithm, however, it's a fault of how you organize the data or how you retrieve data from the system. And that's this game you have to understand and to play. Yeah? So when analyzing a software or analyzing a problem, I mean, first think about, do I ever have to scale? Do I have to worry about that? Yeah. Or is it a no-brainer, a no problem here? Yeah? So there's no data bottleneck in my system. Yeah? And that's something also I think that's important to understand for all systems. So what we will do in this lecture is basically, so these are the objectives of this lecture, the goals, and they're similar to my undergrad lecture, Big Data Engineering. So if you attended that lecture this summer or last summer, you might have seen this slide and similar in certain aspects. The couple of slide changes here. So we will also learn the basic techniques in big data engineering, but we will look a little bit more under the hood, into the algorithms, into the stuff that's going on, into a system that manages large data sets. So we will look at basic techniques, and then second, we will learn to apply those techniques. For that, we have a project in C++. Yes, we have the milestones defined. I will go into details later on, where you should implement certain technologies you learn about in the lecture in a project. We will use our database system Mutable. That's a new database system we are developing at our group. Emanuel Hafner is a tutor and a chief. He's a PhD student in my group. And we will explain all of that, don't worry. Yeah? But it's very important. We believe you will only be able to understand what's going on in this lecture if you try to apply it, if you really try to program it. Many techniques in, say, more practical computer science can and will only be understood if you try to really implement them. Yeah, important, as in all of my lectures, is I really want you to learn to be lazy, to not reinvent the wheel. This happens so often in computer science or data science or databases that people implement stuff that already has been done in a zillion times better ways 30 years ago. So I think it's really important to understand if you analyze a problem to understand, hey, parts of that problem have been solved before, right? So why not use an existing library or tool or algorithm or whatever, rather than reinventing the wheel? And that's very important in computer science, trying to knowing how to map existing problems to existing solutions. And we will do that in the context of big data here, of course. We'll here and there mention things. If people talk about big data, we had a longer session about that in my undergrad lecture when I explained mass surveillance in the context of NSA. I don't go into these applications here that much, but here and there I might say something about ethical aspects, of course. Very important is you should understand what the solutions are for certain applications and what the impact of certain technologies are for certain applications. When it comes to the effort you spend in implementing the system, the performance you will receive as a system, the robustness of the system, that's often neglected. What is robustness? Robustness means, well, there's any problem with your computer system, maybe a power failure, maybe crappy data, maybe whatever a race condition. And so now when you start the system again, if you're able to do that, to start the system again, how do you get back to a consistent state? And that's very important and often neglected. Yeah? I mean, you can always restart from an old backup. Yeah, but if the backup is like 3 months old, what happened to the data that you added or changed in between? So how do you make a system really robust against problems? Yeah, that's a big story in database systems, and we will also look into that. Yeah, extensibility, maintainability, so the typical stuff you would expect to make a system. Yeah, so again, basically it's the same goals as in the undergrad lecture, yet this is kind of part two. We're not as application oriented. We will focus more on the underlying technologies, not so much this application orientation I had in my undergrad lecture. Okay, so there's the first question coming in. I haven't even explained the tools. Cache, can I, that's maybe two. Can I own cache inconsistencies, also cause slow delivery? So we have this tool, I will explain that in a moment, how that works. So it's a moderated chat, it's anonymous, you can register to this Frag Jetzt. Basically, how it works is, well, let's show it now. So there's a QR code, you can just scan that QR code with your cell phone, and then you can, then you enter the session for this lecture, and there you can ask questions. And there my tutor in chief, Christian Schön, is sitting in the background. He will go through the questions. Some of the questions he will answer privately. Some of them he will escalate or push them forward to me. And I will once in a while during the lecture do breaks and then drag this Frag Jetzt window to the stream and then go through those questions. Yeah, so we have a means to interact. Yeah. So we are in this corona situation, it has to be streamed. We can't sit in a physical lecture hall. That's one way of having a feedback channel. There are others in this lecture, but that's one way that I will use during the lecture stream. So you can do that, scan this, and then you enter the session, ask whatever you want to do. And yeah, so that's a very detailed question. Can I own cache inconsistencies also cause slow delivery? So people are voting on that. Yes, that may happen, but I would need to explain a little bit more to too much detail at this point in time. Yes, yeah, short answer, yes, it may happen, but I need some time to explain that, and we don't have that now. So now what I do is, yes, and I think I can also remove it. And fantastic, I removed the wrong question. So the other question was actually, so it ordered while I was looking at it. Okay, those things happen. But the question was, do you have to download fancy C++ programs? No, you will get a library, of our system. You don't have to dig into the source code of the system. You get a library, a neatly defined interface, and you have to code against an interface. Yeah? You get long descriptions on how this works and what we expect you to do, so don't worry. It's really doable as a project. So, all right, where am I? So why can't I delete this question now? Whatever. Okay, so where was I? So here, this is the planned. So basically, we organize the material into questions. So there's an underlying research question, and there's a couple of learning objectives that are associated to that. So if you go through that, so an underlying question here is how to move big data through a computer system. So moving, in particular, through a storage hierarchy, moving it from whatever, a file system to the CPU, to the GPU. Or if you change any data in the CPU, you have to move it back to the storage system. Yeah, and that may happen in both directions. And how do you do that efficiently? Yeah. We will look at a couple of techniques that are important there. One is storage. How to organize your storage? Is it just a file system? Can I do more things there? How does that storage hierarchy actually work? Yeah? What about replicating data? How about caching data, buffering? What are the appropriate read and write strategies? So that's the first part of the lecture. And I think we will spend about a week on that, one and a half week on that. And the next question we will look at is how to speed up a system by improving its data throughput. Again, the story I just told. Yeah? So we're not so much focusing on efficient algorithms. Why would I focus on an efficient algorithm if that's not the bottleneck? So we look at situations where the data delivery is a bottleneck. And of course, if you also understand the algorithm as a bottleneck, we will also fix that one. That's okay. But the focus will be most of the time, data delivery somewhere in the storage hierarchy and how to make it really, really efficient. And that has to do with the following learning objectives, data layouts. So how to organize tabular data in your system. How could you compress the data? And compression here doesn't mean compression to save storage space, but compression to save bandwidth. That's a second unusual use case that's not so well known, but it works very well in database systems. How to find stuff at scale. Yeah, so prominent example, of course, is Google. Yeah? You type in anything and then it, within a blink of an eye, you get a result page with interesting pages that hopefully match what you are looking for. And that goes in the direction of indexing. So you should have attended the algorithms and data structures undergrad lecture or something similar. You should know what a binary search tree is, what a hash table is. Those are called data structures in those lectures. I call them indexes. Databases, those structures are called indexes. And we have some special kind of indexes because the indexes we use and we need have to take into account a little bit more of the storage hierarchy. And that's not necessarily true for binary search trees or all possible hash tables you find out there. There are many tricks you can play to make data structures more efficient. Yeah, we will look into that like for about 2 weeks, I guess. Then we will look into how to compute complex queries at scale. So we touched that a little bit already in the undergrad lecture. So if you've never heard about query optimization, don't worry. I will repeat things quickly here and there, but we'll go a little bit deeper compared to my undergrad lecture. So we will look at, okay, now the user sends a SQL query, a declarative SQL query. How do I translate that query into an efficient program? How do I actually compute the result to a query efficiently? And many things happen from submitting a SQL query to actually scratching the data from disk or from SSD. Many compilation and translation steps are on the way. We will look at that in more detail and a little bit deeper than in the undergrad lecture. Yeah, that's about 2 to 3 weeks, if I remember that correctly. Then how to ensure isolation optimistically. So we looked already at the I in ACID. I will go back to ACID in the recap session in the second part today. So what is isolation again? If you're unsure, read it up again. I will give you a quick idea later on, but you should know what isolation means. And there are different ways to guarantee isolation. In the undergrad lecture, we looked at pessimistic algorithms, log-based algorithms. Here we look at optimistic algorithms. And one super prominent example there is MVCC, multi-version concurrency control, which actually is a family of algorithms. And I'll try to give you a little idea on how that works, because that's the state of the art these days, MVCC. That has been done 20 years ago already in PostgreSQL, but PostgreSQL is a disk-based system, or was invented as a disk-based system, but even in modern main memory database systems, that's the state of the art, and many things you can do with MVCC. And then finally, we will look at robustness. So how do we make a system robust against software and hardware crashes? How does that work? And if you make the database system robust, you can also easily make the application using the database system robust. You get that for free with most database systems. So we will look at crash recovery, failover situations, hot standby, logging, redo, undo, ARIES kind of stuff. So all these techniques that help you make a system That the system is up and running at all times. And even if it says something goes wrong, the system quickly recovers and it's back again and you can use your application. And that's very important for many, many applications. Yeah, so again, distinction here is big data engineering. The undergrad lecture was a focus on principles, design patterns, and fundamental applications of big data technologies. Here, it's more a deeper introduction in the underlying techniques, so more the algorithms that make things happen. Yeah, a little bit about myself. So I run the Big Data Analytics Group. I'm interested in scalable data management and data science. I publish, or try to publish on these venues. Sometimes it works, sometimes it does not. I have a YouTube channel with there's a couple of videos that also are related to this lecture. So once in a while, I will also point you to older videos where I explain similar material or where I explained it for a previous iteration of this lecture. Yeah? So I've been doing videos for like 8 years. The channel has like 11,000 subscribers and you will find a lot of stuff there, but I will actively point you to videos in my slides if you want to repeat stuff. I also coordinate the Bachelor and Master's Data Science and Artificial Intelligence. If you want to know anything about that, just approach me. Yeah, and I'm also active in industry. I was, before joining Zion University, I was 2 years at SAP. I also founded a company, Daemon AI, where we do data science consulting. And we're in the process of founding another company related to blockchain. Yeah, those are the tutors. These are my PhD students. So we basically run the tutorials with PhD students in this core lecture. Christian Schön is the head tutor for basically the entire lecture except the project. Emmanuel is running the project. He's a very experienced developer and coder. Marcel is helping in the lab and Joris is helping in the lab as well. Yeah, so much about the content and the concept of this lecture. Now let's dive into the tools. So we use the CMS that is being used by other lecturers here as well. At Zion University, it's important you register in that CMS. There's no need to register in LSF. LSF is for exams. We're not there yet. It's for the moment, it's just the CMS where you should register because everything will happen through CMS. There's no email or other side channels for submitting stuff or retrieving stuff. If you want to submit anything, you must do it through CMS. And we will explain in detail how that works. Lecture dates is we're here Wednesday 12:15 to 2 o'clock. We have a calendar. Well, maybe I'll open that briefly. Here that doesn't work, the link here, but I can open it. Where are we? So if that's our CMS, the main page. Basically here there's this link information and there's timetable. If you go to that and there you see the different lecture slots, the streams that happen on Wednesdays. And I will add YouTube links here, more or less just in time, like 1 day ahead of time. Latest, you will find the YouTube link here, but you will also find all information under materials. So that's basically the stuff I'm planning to show to you today. And the plan is to always upload it in advance. So before the stream starts, I will upload it to this page. And I will promise to unmute myself whenever I make a drinking break. I forgot it on Monday for a different lecture. And then there was 3 minutes of silent movie, but people pinged me and eventually understood. So if I forgot once to unmute myself, then let me know somehow. Okay, so basically that's the system. It's important you register here. And what else did I want to show? There are a couple of guides here. We'll go to that in a moment, but let's go back to the slides for the moment. So that's the lecture dates, and you might be wondering, hey, there's only one lecture date, right? Well, what's going on here? Because it's a core lecture, there should be two, right? It's two times 90 minutes. That's the reason for that is we are running this lecture as an inverted classroom. So what that means is, where's my slide? I don't have a slide on that, but I show you on the calendar, maybe that's the easiest, if you go to the timetable. So you see here on Fridays 12:15, we have in the calendar a lab. So it's always a lecture on Wednesday, and Friday there's a lab. And what that means is in that lab, we will do exercises. So it's very interactive. I will be there, my PhD students will be there. So it's kind of a hybrid between a lecture where I'm in the front explaining stuff like now, and you doing stuff. So it's really important to us that you, in that lab, that you form groups of 2 to 3 people. We will give you exercises. And then basically you form small groups in the tools in Discord. We will tell you how that works in detail. So basically, if you do it in a real lecture hall, it works as follows. Let's maybe first explain that to understand, and then I make the transfer to the electronic environment. So if you do that in a real lecture hall, you sit in aisles, only every other row is occupied by students, and we walk through the aisles and support you in solving the exercises, the assignments. So we give you hints, you can ask us questions, and basically it's a big interactive lab environment where we try to apply the stuff I told you on Wednesday. So again, in this lecture, it's all about trying to apply the stuff yourself in a team. And that's what we rehearse in that lab. In addition to that, there will be tutorials where we go through material assignments, and in particular their solutions in detail. And it's kind of easy to participate in a tutorial and just listen to the solutions being presented, but that's not how you learn. I really highly recommend that you go to the lab and try to apply the stuff yourself. And the big benefit of such a lab, to my understanding, is you're not alone. Yeah, typically when you get an assignment in a lecture, you go back home and you sit there alone, maybe with peers, other students, trying to solve it. But the lab has really, the difference here is that we are there to help you to get going. I mean, you can also, another idea could be that you start looking at the assignments earlier on and only then go to the lab. But the important thing for you is really you try to solve the stuff yourself. And we are there to help you, to ask questions and support you to get going. And of course, as in other lectures, we will use similar material to the material that then shows up in the exam. So if you can solve the assignments, you will be able to pass the exam, right? If you don't solve the assignments yourself regularly, it will be very hard for you on the exams. But that, there's no difference to other lectures. That's simply how it works here. Okay, so that's CMS, register, very important. Yeah, Corona, no one wants to hear Corona anymore. If you need any more information, there's university FAQ on that. Those are the pages of the Robert Koch Institute. You click on that, you get all the relevant information you ever need. Yeah, that's what I told you already. So everything is virtual, we can skip that. Here's an overview of the tools. So again, here's a link to this Frag Jetzt anonymous moderated chat. We had it here. Yeah, that's this window, the stuff for questions I will use. In addition to that, there's a CMS I showed you already, and there's Discord. Discord is from the gaming community and allows you to do audio, to create audio channels, to chat with people, either in audio or in text. And we have a Discord server that we use for all our lectures, and we use that for the lecture breaks. So in the lecture break, there will be one lecture break, typically 5 to 10 minutes. I will be available on Discord for questions. I can't drag the Discord window to the live stream for privacy reasons, because if one of you shows your real name, that's not the, I shouldn't show that. Yeah. So in the lecture, if you have a question, please ask it on Frag Jetzt. Yeah, ask it on Frag Jetzt, and we will try to quickly respond to that and react to that. In the breaks, you can also ask your questions in audio in Discord. Also, so this means in the lecture break, in the middle of the lecture, and after the lecture, I will also be available, like immediately after the lecture. If you have any questions, let me know, join Discord, and then you're there. To get a link for Discord, you just go to our CMS information Discord guide. I don't show it here because then the link to Discord shows up, and this is a service only available for the students at Saarland University. But if you click here, you will see the invitation link, and then you can join our Discord server. Yeah, so much about that. For the project, we will be using the internal GitLab service of our department, which is great. Details follow. We don't have to go through that now. We have a couple of fallback systems. So Zoom might be a fallback system, but if things go wrong. But currently, and we collect a lot of experience in summer term with YouTube and the setup we're using here. We're very confident that this is a great setup and will work. So I don't see a reason to use any of those tools. So the big advantage for YouTube for you, of course, is you don't have to register. You just click on a link. I don't know who's watching, who you are. There's no privacy problem in that sense. Yeah, stream to YouTube, just like now. No login is necessary. What's also pretty cool, and what I heard from last summer term, is you can do time-shifted viewing. So anytime you don't understand, you just stop, go back, whatever, 30 seconds, listen again, and then you continue. Yeah, maybe you can even catch up in the lecture break. So that's one advantage you have. The other is the stream is archived. You can watch it at any time later on to whatever, to better understand stuff or to prepare for the exam. We will keep it online, and it's the same link. So the link we will publish for the live stream is the same link that's available afterwards to watch the recording. I think that's a pretty cool feature of YouTube, and we get all of that for free. Yeah, Discord, here's basically what you should do. Once you join with that link that's in our CMS, just follow this. The important thing is you enter, you go to the commands text channel and write .rank dbsys. Yeah? With that, you join this lecture or the category database systems in Discord, actually. And then you will see all the text and voice channels there and can participate. So that's very important that you do that. Go to the commands. You can do that later. I don't have to do it now. Or try it out in the break. That's really important. Yeah, CMS. I explained all of that. Again, video collections are available on my YouTube channel or on datenbankenlernen.de. That's another index on older videos, but I will point you to that anyways. Here is a little bit more detail on the lab, how we do it. I explained it already. So basically, we will do a split like that, 15 minutes interactive recap of the last lecture. What did he explain? What's very important? That will not be enough to skip the lecture, don't worry. Just to remind you, we talked about that, right? That's what we talked about on Wednesday. And then we do teamwork, 75 minutes, simple exercises. And that's every Friday, and it's, again, Discord. The cool thing about Discord here, again, is that you can form subgroups, like your own channels, and yeah, the PhD students and myself can walk through these rooms and see what's going on and check what's going on. So don't be afraid if the professor or PhD student joins your room. I really don't care. Yeah, I have a bad memory for names and faces anyway. We are there to help. My idea is to make you successful on the lecture. We are there to help. Yeah. You can also actively call us on the text channels. We will play with that. You will understand how that works. Yeah? So don't worry. Yeah, exercise sheet every Wednesday evening in CMS. There's no hand in required this time. It's really just an exam preparation, and we put it in your hands to try it. Yeah? We don't force you. You should really keep on trying that. And as I said, we will present the sample solutions in the tutorials. But before that, we will go through that in the lab. And it's really important you try it. Otherwise, no chance to pass the exam. No way, right? Yeah, that's again a summary of what I said before. For the tutorials, here we will present sample solutions. You can ask questions about the exercises. And of course, that's all synchronized with the stuff we handed out the previous week. So the current slots for tutorials are Mondays 2:15, that's tutorial 1, and Tuesdays 10:15. Yeah, again, please register in CMS, it's really important, and indicate your preferences for that. Exam sets the dates we received, so we had to do a little bit more planning this time because we have to split you up into more lecture halls to stick to the hygiene measures here. Final exam, February 24th, re-exam, March 24th. And basically what these numbers mean is the project, the programming project, will be the crucial thing here. So it's not that you get 50% in the assignments, it's really the project. So in order to be allowed to the exam, you have to have 50% in the project. That's really important. There's no, as we don't correct your assignments, there's no minimal number of points you have to get there, but the project is really important. And we do functional tests and performance tests and stuff like that. Details follow in order to participate. Yeah, maybe a little bit about the project. So here's a link to the project. There you won't find code. You will get your code through CMS and GitLab. But basically what we will be doing is you implement parts of a database system. Yeah? So the stuff I explained in the lecture, then the week afterwards we will give you a milestone and then we say, hey, now let's you implemented yourself in our system. Yeah, how would you do that? Here's an interface, here's a library, let's do it. And we structured it into three milestones rather than four, because the semester is a little bit shorter. We only do three. We all also do less material this time as the semester is shorter. And then you have roughly 3 weeks to accomplish the milestone. And again, this is teamwork. You must team up to teams of three students. It's important that you have profound programming skills here. And I unmuted. Yeah, that you have profound programming skills. So experience with C++. The project is in C++. You should know about pointers, classes, templates. You should understand object-oriented programming. I mean, as of like programming too, or a little bit more. That's really important. You can use Mac OS or Linux natively, or a virtual machine using Vagrant. So we provide you a virtual machine image that allows you to set up a virtual machine easily. Yeah, and we expect you to do teamwork and roughly equal contribution from each team member. We might check into that, how it works. Teamwork is, let's say, can be a positive or negative experience. These things happen. So sometimes people have difficulties teaming up. Sometimes it's just the people cannot work together. It's not really a problem of the individuals, but those people don't match. It doesn't work. Yeah? And you will find that out quickly, hopefully. And then you either try to resolve it yourself. That's part of the learning experience in computer science. But if you can't resolve it, please escalate it quickly to us. We are there to help you. If there are any issues in your team, if you feel like, oh, I am doing all of the work and the others don't do the work, escalate it quickly. Don't wait to the last moment. Don't send an email to us 5 minutes before submitting your milestone saying, yeah, it didn't work. Yeah, it's a little bit late. Yeah? So my message is, you can also reform groups during the semester if that is required. We can also make meetings to understand problems in your teams if that's required. So these things will happen, but you will also see that many teams will work. And I think it's important that each of you tries to participate equally in the project. That's really, really important. Yeah, that's it for the admin stuff. So I would say I quickly check Frag jetzt. There's nothing there, but if you want, you can send me a question again. Here's a QR code if you have a question in Frag jetzt. But I will also, we will go into the break now for like 10 minutes, and I will be available on our Discord server for questions. Yeah? You can also join the Discord server. Christian is telling me that there are some questions in Frag jetzt. Okay, so I'll wait for that. Scrolly pushing them to me. So let's wait for that. Ah. So many of the things have already been answered. Maybe let's drag it to the screen. Eh? So will lectures be available after the end of it? That's what I said. Yeah. Yeah. It's the same YouTube link. Just click on it. You can rewatch it. No one forces you to watch it. Watch the live stream. You can do it afterwards at night, whenever you want, on the weekend. But of course, you lose the interaction. Yeah? You lose the opportunity to ask back during the lecture. So I would highly recommend doing that and watching the stream live. What else? Other materials, so you can look up information. Yeah, of course they're available. They're also available at datenbanklernen.de. They're available at my YouTube channel. All the old lectures from summer term are available there. You can watch them if you want. They're in German. Yeah, the undergrad lectures in German. Yeah, you can watch it. It's all out there and easy to find on my YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. What else do I have? We provide ways to form. Yes, of course, we will help you with Teams. Yeah, so in Discord, you can team up. I just I suggest you approach people actively to form teams, and we will help you with that, of course. What else do I have here? How much experience do we need with C++? Yes, I said, object orientation, pointers, templates. Should not only be C style, that should really be a little bit of C++ to make things happen. So Java typically is a good foundation. But if you have never programmed C++, not easy. As you should have had some exposure to C++. Makes your life considerably easy. What else? Is a year, that's a trick question. Yeah, it's a trick question because we used to do it every year. Last year we skipped it because there was this, was a new lecture I had to do. So the plan is to do it every year again. That's my plan. Yeah, but I wouldn't call it a promise. Yeah? So I'm planning to do it every year now again. Yeah? Every winter term there will be this lecture, I hope. But I can't guarantee. So maybe if you don't join it now, only in 2 years. So it's guaranteed to happen every other year. Every 2 years it must happen. That's a rule at our department. But it might also happen every year. Huh? Will the exercise during the lab be programming based? Typically not, but there might be overlap. Might also drag parts of the project into the lab. As we deem it suitable, some options and we choose from. No projects, there's no option. You all get the same task. So implement certain techniques in a database system. And there's no option like in programming too, that it's a menu and you choose. No, that's the same things because we believe these things are really important. You try it yourself to understand the stuff. Erasmus students. What does that mean in the exams? Oh, so for registering, I think Erasmus, the problem is typically they can't register in LSF, and we will announce all of that. Don't worry. Yeah? Don't worry at this point in time. It's more about how to get the certificate that you then hand in at your home university. So don't worry. We will handle that and announce it a couple of times again. What else do I have? It's basically no assignment. As I said, we don't correct the assignments. We don't have the manpower for that. We focus on the project. We will present solutions to you in the tutorials. But I strongly recommend that you work in teams in the lab and back home trying to solve the assignments. It's really, really important. You can try yourself as well, but there should be part of your time should happen in a team. need to no, there's no physical thing going on. It's officially not allowed. We thought about that, doing a hybrid model initially for at least the undergrad lectures, but there's no way we put you into a lecture hall for a tutorial or lab style event. That doesn't happen. The lab is gonna be in Discord. It's all virtual. So there's no part of this lecture where you have to attend except the exams. And the final exam and the re-exam. You have to come here because there's no virtual exams being offered at this uni currently. So that's when you have to be here, and that's only end of February and end of March, and following tons of hygiene measures. So don't worry, but everything else is virtual. Yeah, that's how we have to do it. There's not much choice on that dimension. Yeah, so I would say that's it for these questions. So I would say we continue at 20 past one. Yeah, 1:20. So we have 9 minutes, and I will join Discord now. See you then. Okay, so we're back at the lecture. So in the second part, see, we don't have much time left, only till 2 o'clock, that's the plan. So I'll make a quick pass over the most important things you should have seen in some other lecture, some undergrad database lecture, basically. You know? So, and there are three different things I want to go into. Is one is modeling and what this relational model is all about and what entity relationship modeling is all about. You should know all of that. So if you attended my undergrad lecture, no surprises here. It's really fundamental things. But if you're unsure about, if you haven't attended a course in database technology, or if you're unsure whether you know the material, maybe you stick to what follows now. So there are three things I'm going to show in the following. One is entity relationship modeling. The second is relational algebra, which is a foundation of all what we do. It's fantastic. Yeah? You can do all of it. It's very important, even though it's a formalism. Yeah, it is used all over the place, in particular in query optimization, and all kinds of things, all kinds of extensions to relational algebra. And it's super important. And the third is ACID and transactions. I will do a quick recap of what ACID was about, is about, why it is so important, how it relates to the stuff we will handle in this lecture. So with that, let's dive directly into it. So I have to reposition the slide a little bit here. Here we go. So in entity relationship modeling, the idea is to come up with a data model. You have different graphical elements that you need for that. The one is an entity type, the other is a relationship type, and the third is an attribute. And so basically, assume the following situation. Assume a photo agency, photographers taking pictures. So that should be pictures, sorry, photos. Photos is also a valid English term, I guess. And basically, photographers take pictures. And these yellow boxes, the color doesn't matter. I'm just using yellow here for making the visuals look more appealing. Those are the entity types. So that's an entity type photographer, there's an entity type photos. And that's a relationship type take. Yeah? And that's basically how you model this part of the photo agency, this part of the world. So you say there are photographers that take pictures, take photos. And photographers have certain attributes. So they have a last name, they have a first name, they have a date of birth. Photos have an attribute that is the camera that was used to take that particular photo. And maybe they have a GPS coordinate where that picture was taken. And of course, you can basically choose these attributes freely. Yeah, and in ER modeling, basically what you want to model is certain entities. So it's important to make the difference here between entity and entity type. So the entities are the individual photographers, I depicted three here, that take pictures, and they are all generalized into an entity type. So a lot like an object orientation, where you have objects, different objects, and you try to find out what are the commonalities, what are the common features, and then you model that as a class. Same happens in UML for modeling object-oriented frameworks, object hierarchies. Yeah, so it's the same thing. So the individual instances are the entities, but we generalize it into a type, and that's called the entity type. So all of the entities in this entity type have those attributes. And the same holds here. All of the entities, these pictures in that entity type, have the same attributes. Yeah, and then, okay, we can define keys. Those keys will also be important in this lecture when we talk about indexing. But basically, the notation is to define a key, you underline the attributes. So here, I underlined last name and first name, which implies that any combination of last name and first name, if I say whatever, Peter Smith, yeah? Peter Smith, if that is a key, yeah, last name and first name is meant to be the key because I underlined it, that must be unique. So there can only be one Peter Smith modeled by that entity type. That's a bit risky, yeah? Because some people have the same name. So you wouldn't allow for two photographers having the same name with this kind of modeling. That's very risky. So what we often see is in those models is there's an artificial key being introduced, the famous ID. Yeah? There's an ID an artificial key that is unique, and with that, and that's your only key you ever use in those entity types. So that's a person ID, that's I just called it ID, and with that, of course, you could enter two Peter Smith, or you could model two Peter Smiths, as long as they have a different person ID. That's totally fine. And then we also looked at, how can you put constraints on such a data model? So constraints like a photo is taken by at most one photographer. How would that work? Yeah? And that's you can do by using cardinalities, in particular the Chen notation. There are many types of notations for doing that. We used the Chen notation in my undergrad lecture, but other notations exist in that space as well. Huh? And how you read that, and that's a fancy thing, is you always read it to the other side. You say photos determines photographers. In other words, if you have a photo, it's clear which photographer took that photo. That is how you read that notation. And the one also doesn't imply a minimum. It just says, if you have a photo and there's a photographer associated to that photo, there's at most one photographer associated. But this one does not imply that a photographer is associated with a photo. So what may happen is that you have a photo and there's no photographer who is associated to that photo. That's a confusion that often happens. So the one doesn't mean minimum, it only means maximum. So in other words, if you take a photo, there's at most one photographer associated to that. That's the Chen notation. And then we played all kinds of games with that. Yeah, those are the four combinations that exist, and you can think about whether they make sense. Well, in this notation, N and M are just letters that are placeholders for as many as you want. So you could also write a star or something like that. And then you can reason about the different situations you find here. So this means a photographer may only take one photo. So the photographer determines the photo, which is absolutely bullshit modeling. It doesn't make any sense, yeah? Because you want photographers to take many, many pictures, yeah? But if you model it like that, that's what your model says. That's what we just had, yeah? Photos is taken by at most one photographer, which could be questioned, huh? I don't know whether you want to model that. And this means a photographer determines photo, so a photographer can at most shoot one picture. And vice versa, a photo can only be shot by one photographer. So also doesn't make sense. So for a real photo agency, the rightmost modeling scenario should be used. That's the best thing. That's the most general thing you could do. And that's equivalent to not writing cardinalities here at all. So it wouldn't make any constraint here. But that's, in this particular example, the one that should be used. And then another convention we looked at is reading directions. So if you have something like customers rob banks, yeah? So the convention is typically to read it from left to right. So it's clear that the customer robs the banks, but it could also be, if you think about financial crisis, be the other way around, yeah? So maybe it's meant that the banks rob the customers, yeah? So, and that's actually what's implied here by writing down roles. So here, the bank is in the role of a robber, and the customers are in the role of the victim, yeah? So you can denote it using these roles to make these things clear. Recursion, not the recursion you know from programming, but recursion here means that an relationship type is connected multiple times to the same entity type. So photographers are married to photographers. That's how you could express it. Or you could express stuff like photographers have a relationship with photographers, and that could be many here in this situation. Those are things that can be modeled here with entity relationship modeling. Yeah, so that's basically what I wanted to say about entity relationship modeling. And with that, I would go to Frag Jetzt. Is anything? So it's all about the projects and stuff I already answered. So it's not individual, the project. You should do it in a team. No points for the exercise sheets. Why is it at most and not exactly once? Yeah, because that's the Chen notation. If you're unsure about that, read about the Chen notation. This is the one in Chen notation means at most. And that's a big confusion. There's also a min-max notation. I also have a video on that in German on my channel that defines the minimum. But here the minimum is not defined. So that's how this works. Yeah, those are the questions about that one. So if you're unsure about that, please make sure you understand that. There's a lot of follow-up material that explains also how to get to the relational model. And the relational model is the basis of what you then use in a database system as a database schema. We spend a lot of time in the undergrad lecture explaining that. So the first thing is you do this data modeling, doing entity relationship modeling, then you translate that into a relational model, and then the relational model is translated into a database schema. And that's a schema you query using SQL, SQL. So I won't go into SQL today, but I assume that you have had some exposure to SQL. Okay, just briefly switch the slide set. I'll start with part three and then I go to part two because three is even, both are super important. Where is it? There we go. Okay. Okay, a little fine tuning here. Okay. My slides are there. So look at the following situation. We had similar examples. You should have seen undergrad lectures. The bank example, the banking example. Assume you have a bank that has accounts, an accounts table, and in the accounts you store the money that's on the account. So all this money is just virtual. Basically, it's just an entry in a database table. All your money is just an entry, or most of your money is just an entry in a database table. And the accounts table here basically is an ID. That's the account ID. I made a short ID here just for the sake of having a simple example. There's a customer ID, Kundennummer, and that's the current balance. And in the following, I will use a notation that is the current state of this account A, and that's the current state of account B. I just rename it to A and B to make it a little bit simpler. So the situation we are in is, we want to do a bank transfer from one account to the other. So we want to transfer $100 from account A to account B. Yeah. So you can look at the state before that happens, and you can look at the state after that happens. So before we have $1,000 on account A and $2,000 on account B. And after you do that money transfer, it should look as follows. So you should have $100 less here, so 900. And $100 more on account B, that is 2,100, obviously. Yeah? And in between, anything may happen. There may be some in-between state. What we know is that before it is this state, and afterwards it's this state. Okay? That is what we are talking about. We'll be talking about in the following. And basically, if you look at what happens, how the data manipulation happens in such a system is as follows. Basically, I now read the current state, the current balance from account A, capital A, that is the account, and I read it into a local variable, this small a, that's my local variable, and that is 1,000. If you go back, that's current state, 1,000. So here I read 1,000. Then in memory, I deduct $100, and then I write the new balance to the system. So what this means, the 900 is now written to this account A. In the table. I have to do the same thing for the other account. Yeah? The other account receives 100 bucks, so I read the current state into this local variable b, small b, add 100 bucks, and write the new state back to the accounts table. Yeah, that's basically what happens. Well, another, what's the problem? The problem with that is, of course, if anything goes wrong, yeah, assume a crash happening right after writing the new state of A, then of course you lost 100 bucks, yeah, because those 100 bucks were never received on account B. So basically the bank has now 100 bucks more, yeah, deducted 100 bucks here, but never put it on any other account. You know? And that's a problem. You don't want to have that, of course. And the bank might want to have it, but from the point of view of a customer, it's not such a great idea. So what we do to fix that is, of course, we use transactions. Yeah? We had that at length in the undergrad lecture. Basically, what we say is, yeah, you can do that. That's fine. But we put all of that into one atomic unit, which means the system has to understand that, please, system, you can please do this sequence of operations, but you either do all of them or none of them, all or nothing. And that property is called asset. It's atomicity, it's the A in asset. And now if anything crashes, if anything goes wrong while executing these individual operations, the system must be able to go back to the state that existed before. So we must not be in the 900 state here, we must be in the 1000 is a balanced state on account A, otherwise that would be invalid. Okay, so that's the idea of a transaction. Basically, the system rolls back to the old state as it was in when starting the transaction. And like that, we make sure that the money is not gone. Huh? So encapsulating it into a transaction. And that's called the A property or atomicity, all or nothing. And yeah, it has various flavors and aspects. We talked about that in the undergrad lectures. Yeah, the second property is consistency. Consistency means a transaction must not violate consistency at commit time. Now, what is consistency? There are many ways to define that, but an obvious thing in a bank scenario is, well, if you compute the balance over all accounts, the sum of the money that's available on all accounts in your bank, you get a certain number here. Then you do the transaction, and then you do the balance again. And obviously, the number you compute here on top must be the same as the number you compute down there, right? Yeah. If that's not the same number, money got lost or was added magically, that mustn't happen. And what consistency says is whatever the state was here, when we want to commit the transaction, we must compute the same state here. So whatever you compute as a sum here, say it's 42 or whatever, you must also receive 42 here. If the sum is X here, it must be X here and not anything different. However, while computing the transaction, the local view to the transaction may differ. So the transaction may have the idea that no, the sum is different. And that happens, for instance, here. If you write this new balance to account A, and if you now execute the sum, then of course the sum is by 100 lower than before. And that is okay. While doing the transaction, from the point of view of the transaction, it may look inconsistent. The important point is when the transaction is done with its stuff and when it wants to commit, it's important that the consistency is preserved again, that you're back to the old sum. Yes, is that, and that happens here basically by adding the new balance, which is 100 bucks more than before, to this other account, then the sum will be correct again. Yeah, so consistency may be violated while doing the transaction, but not when trying to commit. And that's a C. The third is isolation. That's the I. Concurrent transactions must not influence each other. And you may know these situations from programming lectures like concurrent programming, stuff like that. So the problem is isolation is typically something like that, that assume two transactions. Again, the timeline is going from top to bottom. You execute these statements, you're reading the balance from account A, here from C, you do some stuff, write back the new balance. But then both transactions concurrently operate on the same account B. So one is reading the current balance, the other as well. Then locally in memory, you add 100 bucks here, 300 bucks. And now they're both writing to the same account. And no matter who writes first in this situation, the new update from the other transaction will be lost. Yeah. So if you write this 100 first, then it will be overwritten with this 300 extra bucks, and you will lose this update. That's called a lost update, and that's something you must avoid, of course, otherwise you're really in trouble. So for this, serialization is required. And we looked at that theoretically, like the serialization graph, conflict graph, stuff like that, how to handle it on a theoretical level in the undergrad lecture, but also on the practical level with two-phase locking algorithms, strict two-phase locking, deadlock, stuff like that. We did that in the undergrad lecture already. And the fourth property is durability. So durability means that changes done by a committed transaction must be preserved. And here, look at the following scenario. Now the time runs from left to right. We have two transactions. One is transferring 100 bucks from A to B, the other from 300 from C to B. And yeah, well, what happens if you have a crash? Yeah, assume here this transaction, or let's first look at the positive situation. Let's assume we are in a situation where the transaction wants to commit. Yeah, that's what that's where we are here. So the transaction ends, the green box ends, and the transaction told the application committed. The data was committed. The transaction was run successfully. Then the database system makes a contract. And the contract is the database system is not allowed to lose the data at any time anymore. So if the database system tells the user that it committed successfully, the database system must make sure that it's never going to lose the data. Yeah, and that's durability. So it will not lose the data. Committed data must not be lost. And that is what durability is about. Yeah. So here, of course, if you have a crash while transaction two is running, that would already violate atomicity, yeah, because we said, okay, all or nothing. And here, not all of it was executed. So whatever the changes are here, they must not become durable. So if while running the transaction, you fiddled around with the state of the database system, that must be removed. That's really, really important. And some algorithms don't do that. You have to be really careful. So a transaction that never committed must not become durable if a crash happens at any time. That's very important. And also consider the situation if the crash happened here. Yeah. And this stuff was only available in my memory, but not put on a persistent medium like a hard drive on SSD. The contract says, I committed. The database system committed. So whatever I did here, it must be persistent. It must be durable. So when I start the database system again, you must be able to look it up. Yeah? And if you didn't write it here to a persistent medium, then you're really in trouble. Yeah? So this goes a lot. We will look at that in more detail. I will also repeat those scenarios here because we didn't look at that in that much detail in the undergrad lecture. But that's something to worry about in the database system in order to make these systems robust. And we will look at that in more detail. Yeah, those are the four properties. So ACID, atomicity, consistency, isolation, durability. And again, if you haven't had any exposure to that, it might be difficult in this lecture. If you forgot about that, reread about that in the next weeks, because it's really important for this lecture. I will assume that you understand those concepts in this lecture. Okay, so with that, I would again check out Frag Jetzt. What do we say on Frag Jetzt? Someone a JSON template? No, this is not about JSON. JSON is JavaScript object notation. No, sorry, that's not something I'm going to explain here, because data modeling, if you don't know, if you want to do data modeling, use a relational model. Yeah, maybe I'll highlight that question. I'll make it. So that's a question here. JSON is often used to do ad hoc schemas, yeah, and that's fine. You can do that. Yeah, you can instantly write it down. And you can also do that with a database schema. However, if it's a real, if it's a complex model, you have this many, many different relations, many different entity types, relation types, relationship types, then you will be in trouble. Yeah, it's the same if you just directly write it in JSON. It's the same as directly start programming without having a design, without having the concepts. Yeah, so directly starting to program is fine for small projects, but if it gets a little bigger, you're in trouble. And that's why I will preach throughout this lecture, and I'll preach throughout the undergrad lecture. If you want to do it right, you have to design. You have to think about concepts first, and then you implement. And that is why we have those steps. We first have entity relationship modeling, then we have relational model, and then we have a database schema. Because like that, you avoid many, many mistakes. In contrast, you start with JSON, extend it over time. I've seen those schemas. I can only recommend against that. Okay, what else do we have here? Since I had basic undergrad, that was big data engineering BDE that we should. Basic log-based concurrency definitely helps. Asset properties, so what I'm showing here, relational algebra, I will go into that briefly. No, that's all you need, I would say. Yeah, that's basically all you need. So I will recap some of the query optimization. So in the undergrad lecture, we also do query optimization, rule-based and cost-based, but I recap quickly some of those concepts here. So it helps if you have seen that before, but it's still okay if you haven't seen it before. I will recap the most important things. Yeah, so other than the stuff I'm showing in this recap, there's, SQL, of course. Yeah, you should have seen SQL. Yeah, because I will show SQL examples, and then I will say, okay, how do we translate that SQL statement into a program? And if you can't read the SQL statement, it doesn't make sense for you, right? So you should know some basic SQL as of the 92 standard, a very old standard, but the basic things you will find in SQL. It's really important. What else do we have? Okay, that's basically what I'm seeing here. So with that, I would briefly, and the slides are all available in the CMS. You should have seen that. So with that, I would briefly dive into relational algebra. And that's a notebook. I've shown the following, a Jupyter notebook that I used in the undergrad lecture. So here and there in the lecture, I might be showing Python examples. So I assume that you had exposure to a scripting language. I'm not sure whether all of you know Python, but Python is really easy, and the stuff I use in Python is relatively easy. And Python is a nice means for explaining stuff in the sense that it is a good that allows you to combine visual output with very small code fragments very effectively. So we use that heavily to explain stuff in the undergrad lecture, and here and there I might also use it to explain stuff. So with that, let's switch to the notebook. So that's exactly the notebook we're using in the undergrad lecture explaining relational algebra. And what I'm using here is a sample data set from IMDb, this movie database. So a stripped down version, smaller version. So I create a couple of relations here. And then basically, I have commands available to print those relations. So here I have the director's relation. This is a schema of that relation. So I have attribute ID of type integer. I have the first name type string and so forth. And I have three tuples with those values. So that's the ID, that's the first name, that's the last name. The real database has many more tuples, tens to hundreds of thousands of tuples and so forth. Basically you can also write that as a graph, which means a relation in such a graph in relational algebra is just a bubble. Now, that's an input bubble on the bottom of the graph. It's just a leaf in a binary tree. We will get to that. And then in relational algebra, you have a couple of base operators. Yeah? And one is a selection. So basically, selection is a filter operation allowing you to filter certain movies. I say, okay, based on this existing relation, movies, I want to only have those movies that appeared after 2000. So have a year attribute that's bigger than 2000. And then when I print it here, I basically get the expression in relational algebra. That is a sigma underscore, and then this is a condition as you do it. If you see these examples on slides, on textbooks, you see exactly that notation. Yeah, and if I want to print the result, I just call this one, and then that's now executed on a bigger, slightly bigger data set. And here you see, okay, those are the movies that appeared after the year 2000. Those are the ones that qualify. And depending on how you set this filter condition, you will get a different results. Okay. Here we can also depict the graph. That's a nice feature now of Python. So previously we had to put that on some lecture slide and PowerPoint and Keynote and scribble that here. You can directly get the real graph that's behind that computation. And the graph is saying, okay, this is a bottom-up computation. It's always bottom-up, from bottom to top, you read it. The input is a movies relation, and there's a scan operator, a selection operator, selecting all tuples where the year attribute is strictly greater 2000. That is what I'm computing here with relational algebra. And like that, you have all kinds of fundamental operators. You have, for instance, a projection. I'm projecting certain attributes away. So the resulting graph is something like that. You add a projection saying, okay, I only want to have want to see these two attributes. I only want to have the ID attribute and the year attribute. So if I execute that, I only get those two attributes and not the others anymore. Here had a couple of more attributes. When I say I'm only interested in those attributes, only those attributes will be displayed. Then you have set style operations, as you know from set logics. So I can union. A relation is a set. I can union two sets, and that's what I'm doing here. So here I'm union. I call a union on good movies and new movies. Oh, that's difficult. Yeah, in relational algebra, that basically looks like that. You can evaluate it. It looks like this, and the plan. Now all of a sudden there's a tree. Yeah, you see, okay, here we have so a real tree before. It's obviously a binary tree. All of these plans are binary tree. You can generalize it to DEX, that's fine. But for the sake of simplicity, we only have binary trees here. But what you see is that's basically a union. Here we have these selection operators, the filter operators, and that is basically what's being computed. That's the expression that tells you what is being computed. And yeah, there are all kinds of these operators. I invite you to go through that, through this notebook again. I also already highlighted that in the undergrad lecture. So in relational algebra, if you go back here, actually what you have in those expressions are those Greek letters. Yeah? So in a logical plan, we talked about logical and physical plans already. I will recap that again when we're there in December in query processing. There's logical and physical plans in databases. And basically here, you already see that's a logical expression being computed. That's a selection. And the physical algorithm behind that is this one. So this is already a so-called physical operator telling you how things are computed. For instance, here the hash, the union is done doing a hash-based algorithm. Yeah. Don't worry, we'll go into that. For the moment, wherever you are from, whatever undergrad database lecture you attended, it's important you know the logical expressions, relational algebra. If you don't know the physical algorithms behind that, don't worry, we will go into that. But the logical expressions, so the Greek letters, or these union and intersect symbols, that you should know about. That's really important. Huh? Yeah, and maybe you walk through that a little bit. There are some very special operators. One is a join operator that, I'm not sure, do I have to define stuff here to make it happen? Yeah, that's a join operator that basically reconstructs larger portions of the schema. So basically what we do in entity relationship modeling is we split the state metal splits entity types into different entity types, and then when querying you want to put them together again. Yeah, and that is what a join is doing. The join is combining entity types across relationship types. Yeah, and that's what the purpose of a join. And basically, when you enter a join in SQL, it's eventually translated into relational algebra style expressions and then executed. We will go into that, but it's important to understand the semantics of the join. If you're unsure about that, look it up again. There's a lot of material out there. The same holds for grouping, yeah? Aggregation style queries. For instance, if you want to count the number of actors with respect to a specific gender is available in the database. If you want to have male and female, there's no diverse in this database here, but male and female, and the number of tuples having that attribute value, you can do these aggregations or grouping and aggregation. And that's also something we will look into many, many times. So make sure you understand that. Make sure you understand how grouping and joins work in SQL. Make sure you understand how that works in relational algebra, and then you're all good to go for this database lecture. Yeah, so all of this material is online. I invite you to take a look at that till Wednesday next week. With that, is there anything else? Let's look at some questions. What is here? It's basic English. No. Yeah, okay, that was already answered here. So some of the stuff is already answered directly by Christian sitting in the background. Yeah, so basic SQL, I really mean so where clause, group by, joins, projecting stuff, how does it work? Maybe we'll look here and there at a subquery, but then I will explain it anyway again. So it's really basic SQL. You should, basic SQL statement, you should see it and immediately understand what the heck is that good for. That's what you need. So it's not much. Why don't we just use an... okay, I will... yeah, that's a good one. Sorry. So this relates to buzzwords. NoSQL is a buzzword, and this is a long and funny story about that. And NoSQL are by no means, no as in 100% no, a replacement for relational database technology. NoSQL was introduced with a lot of wild claims, and most of them are wrong, except... Scale out. If you really like run a database over Facebook, for Facebook and Google, there are certain situations where NoSQL makes sense. Certain tiny, small situations. But for most of you, I guarantee relational database technology will do the job. So there's no real advantage of a NoSQL system. We will go to that in some detail. So this NoSQL movement came with a lot of wild claims, and most of them are absolutely wrong from the point of view of relational database technology. In particular, the engines, the algorithms they use in those systems are like sometimes from the 70s. They're really, really inefficient and don't make any sense. We will go into that in more detail. I will mention that here and there. That's one of my favorite topics, actually. Yeah, what else do I have? That's it from my side. I think I answered all of those. Yeah, that's what I answered. So we'll see each other again next Wednesday. Let's make sure to refresh your knowledge about the stuff I just recapped. Make sure you register in CMS, look at the tools a bit. Oh, yeah, one thing I wanted to mention is there's a forum. Yeah, there was one question in the lecture break, someone asking, what if I have a question? Can I put it in text somewhere? Yes, please do it in the forum. We also had that in the undergrad lecture in summer, and was heavily used. It was a lot of fun, actually. Very interesting questions there. So if it's about not understanding something correctly or whatever, or you have a witty observation to make, do it. We will look at that regularly. So PhD students will look at that. I will look at that regularly. But if you're a student and feel like you have an answer, you can also answer it. You can also organize among yourselves. That's fine. But we will also supervise it a little bit and give hints here and there. So I think it's a good means to learn even more about the material. So that's a forum, and directly accessible from our CMS. With that, let's call it a day. I'm looking forward to teaching this stuff to you. If you have any questions, let me know. I will be available in Discord right now after the lecture. Bye-bye and see you then.